Hello, everyone. It's Dr. James Marcum here with another Biblical Prescription for Life. Today, we're going to talk about the new Yale pandemic study, and it also describes a new medical syndrome. Lots of people are talking about it, including the New York Times, many people around the world. So I wanted to bring this to you as well as my perspective on this. But first, let's start with a biblical prescription, and that's John 8:32. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Truth is important, my friends, and it just doesn't go away. And as this world progresses, we must not be afraid to tell the truth. Not that everyone is going to help us get the truth out there, but we have to be true to ourselves, true to our conscience, true to the promptings of the Holy Spirit. Several years ago, I wrote this book, Medicines That Kill. And if we think about our physiology, everything that we put in our body, all the inputs, they're either positive inputs or negative inputs. That includes the food that we eat, the thoughts that we have, a myriad of inputs. We also have good inputs, which changes for the good, worship, scripture, being with other believers, praising, thanking. There's lots of things that help us for the good, but there's also inputs that damages. The physiology behind all of these inputs are complex, but it includes inflammation, turning on the immune system, which can affect our genetics, our epigenetics. It can cause different mutations that age us. When we have aging, we have problems with our genetics, which is our DNA, that can cause, if there's problems, that can cause us to have malfunctions in different organs, which can cause us to have symptoms. We have the symptoms, we go to the doctor for evaluation. So the point is there's all these inputs around us that we have to pay attention to. They're either making us better or making us worse. Usually, these inputs turn on different physiologic mechanisms. Sometimes it turns on the immune system, and if it's turned on chronically, we call that chronic inflammation. Well, several years ago, I wrote this book, Medicines That Kill, and I was very concerned about all the medicines, these inputs. They had some good things that were happening to us, but they also had a lot of bad things as well. And I can remember in doing the research for this body, I was amazed that every medication, every input for medication, every intervention has a side effect. That's why you have to really pay attention to the risk benefits. Well, one of the medicines on there, and it was on page 55 of this book that I looked at years ago. This was, I think I got this book came out in 2013, but I was looking at all of the medicines that were once on the market. Remember, they were on the market, but they were pulled off pretty quickly. There's been many medicines that had been on the market. I can remember one I saw for weight loss when I first started my practice, Finfin, that was gone. Cisapride, Reglan, many other medications that were once on that are now gone. Well, one of them on was called Vioxx. And Vioxx was a medicine that was designed for arthritis to decrease the inflammation. And it was a gene-based medication. It had to do with your genetics. And anyway, Merck, who made that, they approved it by the FDA in 1999, but they pulled it off of the market in 2004, okay? And that was after about 25 million people had taken that medication. And basically, it took a seven-year investigation by the United States attorney in Massachusetts before they figured it out. And the company did have to pay a criminal fine and that, but they took it off the market. That was the good news. But, you know, many people, they recommended they had over 6,000 or so adverse events, including death. Well, the point I want to make is that these inputs, these physiologic inputs from medical interventions, including medications, can be an input that triggers our immune system. Well, this new study talks about a new syndrome that's triggered by viral intervention. And, you know, they call this the PVS syndrome. Some of the symptoms of this new syndrome that's triggered by viral interventions are fatigue, tingling, brain fog, exercise tolerance, insomnia, and dizziness. Well, in this study, and the researcher Iwasaki from Yale has done a lot of immunological research. His team has been doing lots of these, and they specifically looked at some individuals, 42 healthy individuals that had this PVS syndrome. They compared it to 22 that were healthy. So my point is making is all of these people, except the controls, had different inputs that seemed to change their physiology, specifically their immune system, causing these symptoms. Well, they looked at the 42 healthy people. And the average age of these were about early 40 years old. There was 29 females, 13 males in this. And a lot of these people in this group, 15 of these, had just had the viral intervention, but no virus disease at all. And the virus we're talking about is, of course, the COVID. So they had the intervention, but no disease at all. And what these researchers noted that in this group, they had had only they had the viral intervention. They didn't have any of the virus itself. They were pretty much healthy completely before this. And then they developed this syndrome, fatigue, tingling, brain fog, exercise tolerance, lots of symptoms. And they're calling it a PVS syndrome, post-vac syndrome. So there are some limitations of this study, and a lot of people that know more than I do that talk about it, but I wanted to sort of make it simple. Remember, any type of input we get can cause problems and turn on the immune system. So it looks like in this study that this viral intervention changed the immune system. The conclusions that they made, the take-home points, were they noted that this post the viral intervention, it caused shifts in the immune system of those that developed this syndrome. Specifically, it decreased the CD4 cells and it changed the way the immune system was working. Remember, the immune system is very complicated. And the people of this study did all sorts of analysis on antibodies and different things. And what they noticed is that the people that had the syndrome, including those that had the viral intervention, many of them had changes in their immune system, specifically the CD4 cells. Another thing that they noticed that they had the group that became sick, they had increased levels of the S protein after the viral intervention. They both had that in the group that had no virus and also those that did have the virus. So that makes sense because any type of foreign input is going to change our immune system to some degree. Another thing that they noticed in those people that got the viral intervention, that it was still in the blood up to 700 days after they got the viral intervention. There were some limitations in this study, but one of the pros of it is that Iwasaki's group, they have this listen group where they're studying a lot of these types of people, the people that have had adverse reactions to some of these interventions. So they followed many of them, and they had the greatest medical technology in looking at the immune system that we have. But we noticed in this study, there also was 28 different authors that put their names on the study. That's good. However, this study did have a small study size. It was not peer-reviewed. And here, I think, is one key point. They really, the people that got sick, those ones that had the post, they had the viral intervention, but no disease, and then they had this syndrome with, they still had evidences of this S protein in their blood. What they did not do originally is they didn't evaluate their genetics at baseline to see if there was something that would predispose these genes to have adverse response when it was related to this stressor. And this is very common that we see. Remember, stressors from any input affects everybody a little bit different based on their genetics. So that was not done in this study, but everyone's talking about it. It's very important because it's going to spur us to look more into these things, more into the immune system. And I think it's going to let us know that those that had viral interventions, and there were many people, much more viral interventions than people that got Vioxx, which was another intervention that was pulled from the market, but it took years because it was harming people. This viral intervention that was given, it shifts the immune system, and they noticed that it even increased developing viruses like Epstein-Barr virus. It changed the immune system, but what was more significant, I thought, was this S protein from this viral intervention was still in the blood up to 700 days in some people after they received it. This was not supposed to happen. And they're supposing that this chronic stressor that's in the body is chronically stimulating the immune system. And based on individual genetics, they're having different symptoms from fatigue to tingling to brain, exercise intolerance. But some people are affected much more. And this is something that I deal with regularly. This is the endothelium and the small lining of the blood vessel. And here is a picture of the endothelium. Well, the host of different types of stressors on the body can damage the endothelium as it turns on inflammation. So this endothelium can, of course, be damaged from any stressor that turns on your immune system. And of course, your individual genetics sort of determine which people are really revved up a lot and which ones aren't. But it's very important to me because if this inflammation were to be able to damage other parts of the body, we could see other problems existing. So a lot of people are talking about this new Yale pandemic study. It was small, but it opened up some new doors. And I'm hoping that now in 2025, we're able to talk about these viral interventions that have been given to many, many, many people and admit some people are having problems, whether it be called post-COVID or this new PSV, this or PVS syndrome, it's going to yet be determined. So I'm sure you're going to hear more about this in the days and weeks to come. I just wanted to give you a preview of sort of my thoughts. But as we end today, I want us to get us back to this text, John 8:32. You shall know the truth. The truth sets you free. And the truth is found in the Bible. The scriptures are authority. And the scripture points us to the real healing remedy of the world, the treatment for chronic disease, and that's Christ. And in that, not only can we have permanent healing forever, but we can have freedom. We don't have to have fear. We don't have to have these things that are dominating our society. We have a way to deal with these stressors that are going to continue to bomb our body. We don't know it's going to be forever. But truth is important. We must speak out. We must think for ourselves. We might get knocked down by others, but we have to keep on keeping on. So I hope this gives you a little insight as you hear eventually about this new syndrome and this new study that many are talking about. If you like it, give it a thumbs up. Share this with your friends and neighbors. And I'm going to be back soon with yet another biblical prescription for life.